For calculating cubical dilatation, we will again consider a very small region, and then we will consider a deformed region. But instead of a line or rectangle, we will consider a volumetric element in the neighborhood of a point. So let's consider a volumetric element, and this volumetric element we will take in a shape of parallelepiped. So before deformation, this parallelepiped was denoted by the points P, Q, R, S, and other points. And after deformation, it has took the shape like this, and the new points has been represented by P dash, Q dash, R dash, and S dash. Initially, the sides of this parallelepiped were delta X, delta Y, and delta Z. And after deformation, it has become delta X dash, delta Y dash, and delta Z dash. In the previous slide, we have used the expressions of delta X dash, delta Y dash, and delta Z dash. So we will use these three expressions for deriving the expression of volumetric strain. In this procedure, we will start with an aim to find deformation in single side. Let's assume the side PQ. So if we want to find out the deformation in this line PQ, then what we will need to do? So we know that the length of PQ can be decomposed into X, Y, Z component. So X component will be delta X, Y component will be 0, and Z component will also be 0. And for PR line, the X component will be 0, Y component will be delta Y, and Z component will be delta Z. And for this PS line, our delta means our X component will be 0, Y component will also be 0, and Z component will be delta Z. So now, can we find delta X dash, delta Y dash, delta Z dash of line P dash, Q dash? Yes, definitely. Just put delta X is equal to delta X, but delta Y 0, delta Z 0, delta Y 0, delta Z 0, delta Y 0, delta Z 0. Finally, the components of length P dash Q dash will be obtained by putting delta Y and delta Z is equal to 0. So you will get delta X dash is equal to 1 plus dou UX by dou X into delta X, and delta Y dash will take this form, and delta Z dash will be obtained by this expression. Similarly, we can write the component of length P dash R dash by substituting delta X is equal to 0, delta Z is equal to 0. So finally, we will get delta X dash is equal to this, delta Y dash is equal to this, and delta Z dash is equal to this. Similarly, just put delta X is equal to 0, delta Y is equal to 0, and you will get the component of length P dash S dash. And here are the expressions of all these components of P dash S dash. So once we know the length of P dash Q dash, P dash R dash, and P dash S dash, then just take vector multiplication, and you will get the volumetric strain. So how we take vector multiplication? For that, we can take the help of matrices. So the deformed volume will be V dash is equal to length of line P dash Q dash, length of line P dash R dash, and length of line P dash S dash. So this can be calculated with the help of determinant of this matrix. I think it's straightforward, so any explanation for this determinant is not required. Next, now let's simplify this expression. So V dash is equal to this thing, and V dash is equal to this determinant already derived. Now if you simplify it, then you will get V dash is equal to this term multiplied by this term multiplied by this term, and you will get higher order terms. Now let's write this V dash is equal to initial volume plus changed volume. So V dash will be equal to V plus delta V, and the right hand side is written as written in the previous equation. Now we know that this delta X, delta Y, delta Z denotes the initial volume of the parallelepiped. So if we divide this whole equation by V, then we will get 1 plus delta V by V is equal to this thing plus plus higher order term. And we know that volumetric strain is equal to delta V by V. So if we cancel out this one by this one, and if we ignore the higher order term, then we will get delta V by V is equal to approximately this, equal to approximately summation of these three terms. So this will be our volumetric strain. And we know that this dou ux by dou x represents epsilon x, this represents epsilon y, and this represents epsilon z. So finally, our volumetric strain will be equal to epsilon x plus epsilon y plus epsilon z. Our next topic is principal strain. So as we already know about principal stresses, so we don't need much explanation about the principal strain. Principal strain represents similar thing as principal stresses. So, but still, let's understand what this principal strain means. So if you take any plane where shear strain values are zero, so all the normal strains will represent the principal strain of that plane. So if you write a strain tensor on a principal plane, then your strain tensor will look like epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3, and all the shear strain components will be zero. Okay, now let's derive the expressions of, now let's see how to derive, how to determine the principal strain related to any particular reference frame. As we are familiar with the derivation of principal stresses and their direction, so I will not go in all details of the derivation of principal strains and their directions, but I will cover all the important steps that are essential for solving numerical problems. So let's start with this constitutive equation. These three equations are very similar to the equations used in principal stresses. For a non-trivial solution, where this epsilon xx represents strain in x direction, here nx, ny, nz represents direction cosine of principal plane, and this epsilon represents the principal strain. The terms exy represents half of gamma xy, exz is half of gamma xz, and eyz is half of gamma yz. For non-trivial solution, the determinant of coefficient of this homogeneous equation should be zero. So if you take determinant, you will get equation of this form, where J1 represents summation of epsilon x, epsilon y, and epsilon z, and Z2 represents summation of these three matrices, and Z3 represents determinant of this 3 by 3 matrix. These J1, J2, J3 are known as strain invariants whose value does not depend on the frame of reference. So if you take any frame of reference, the values of J1, J2, J3 will remain same. So now coming back to this equation, if we take roots of this cubic equation, then the roots will represent principal strains, and the you will get three principal strains. They are written as epsilon 1, epsilon 2, and epsilon 3. It is also important to note that the axis of principal strains epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3 are mutually perpendicular. So in this way, we find out the principal strains. But what about their direction? How to find out direction of each principal strain? So we will follow the same procedure as used in the analysis of stress. What we'll do? We will substitute the value of epsilon 1 in these three equations, and we will solve for nx, ny, and nz. The obtained value of nx, ny, nz will represent the direction cosine of epsilon 1. Similarly, we will substitute the value of epsilon 2 in these three simultaneous equations, and if we solve for nx, ny, nz, then the obtained value of nx, ny, nz will represent the direction cosine of epsilon 2. And the same procedure can be used for calculating the direction cosine of epsilon 3. Okay. Okay, so let's understand this whole procedure of determining the principal strain and their direction with help of a numerical problem. So, state of strain at a point in the body is given to us, and we need to find out the values of principal strains and their directions. So, what we will do? First step will be to write these three simultaneous equations, and we know that for non-trivial solution, we need to equate this determinant equal to zero. This determinant gives us a cubic equation of this form, and in this cubic equation, how we find out the value of J1, J2, J3? The value of J1 is obtained as summation of these diagonal elements. So if we add these three elements, we will get J1 is equal to 0.01. Okay, and J2 will be equal to mod 0.01, 0.03, 0.03 minus 0.005. Okay, so 0.01, 0.03, 0.03 and minus 0.005 plus mod of 0.01 minus 0.08, then minus 0.08 and 0.005 plus mod 0.005 minus, that means this term, and again 0.005 and 0.01 and here 0.01. Okay, so this will give us J2 and expression of J3. J3 will be determinant of this 3x3 matrix. That means determinant of epsilon I j. So in this way we can find out the values of J1, J2, J3, and just substitute these values in this cubic equation, and you can find out the roots epsilon 1, epsilon 2, and epsilon 3. Next, substitute this value of epsilon 1 in these three simultaneous equations and solve for nx, ny, and z. So there are three equations and three unknown, nx, ny, and z. So you can easily find out the values of nx, ny, and nz. Similarly, substitute the value of epsilon 2 and you can find out another set of nx, ny, and z. They will represent the direction cosine of epsilon 2, and similarly you can find out the direction cosines of epsilon 3, and that will be your final answer.